This is the European flag. You've seen it outside that hotel you stayed at in Paris, and that one time you had a layover at Heathrow, and you were like, what's the deal here, Europe? Why is it blue? Why are there 12 stars? And is this design a perfect metaphor for how compromise, sovereignty, and national interest produce arbitrary outcomes? I'm gonna answer all those questions, but I'm gonna have to start at the beginning. Okay, so it's right after World War II, and all the European countries and the rest of the world are convinced that economic and political cooperation is the only way they're gonna prevent another war. We tend to think of this period as this, like, inevitable march toward the European Union, but at the time, it wasn't obvious the EU was gonna happen at all. There were dozens of organizations and institutions advocating for European cooperation, but they were all competing over what it should look like and who should be in charge. One of the organizations that pops up at this time is the Council of Europe, which sounds super boring and sort of is. Winston Churchill is newly unemployed, and he has this idea of a United States of Europe. He convinces the 10 most powerful European countries to join up and agree to principles of human rights and democracy and rule of law. Right after it's founded, the Council starts passing treaties and conventions, and establishing many of the acronyms that still baffle us today. So like all successful startups, the Council of Europe decides they need to redesign their logo. Starting in 1950, they ask for proposals for a flag. The first proposal is by a guy named Richard Nicholas Coudenhove Kalergi. He's been advocating for a United States of Europe since right after World War I. And his flag is such a famous symbol of integration that it's already being used on postage stamps. Lots of people, including members of the council, think they should just take up Kalergi's symbol as their own. One problem. The council needs unanimous approval for the flag design. Turkey sees the proposal and is like, a cross? Are you kidding me? The next proposal is from Duncan Sandys, who's Winston Churchill's son-in-law, so you know he's like super qualified. He wants the council to use this hideous green E on a white background. The E was originally red, but there were a few European events where the wind wasn't blowing, and everyone thought it looked like the communist flag, so they changed it to green. This idea gets rejected not because any particular country objects, but basically because it is terrible and everyone calls it Churchill's underpants. The next proposal is this one, going for a sort of Olympics vibe. It's actually sort of handsome, but the council members think it looks too much like a rotary telephone, or the number zero, or sort of like a chain, so... The council also considers this minimalist one, until they realize that it looks exactly like the flag of the Belgian Congo, and even back then they were like, whoa, too soon. There's also a maximalist proposal, a flag with a star for every European capital. This was actually a frontrunner for a while, but then someone pointed out that most people do not know European geography to this extent. Like, I live on this continent and I can't name half of these. The council also considered some minor proposals, but these are so buckled they never had much of a chance, so we're not gonna dwell on them. The guy in charge of deciding which of these proposals to send to the members is Paul Levy, a Belgian journalist who refused to collaborate with the Nazis, got sent to a concentration camp, somehow got released to German surveillance, then snuck to Britain and spent the rest of the war working for the resistance. Legend has it Levy was walking past a statue of the Virgin Mary in Brussels, and he saw a halo of stars around her and he thought, that's it! Stars in a circle! Like most national myths though, it probably is one. As you recall from like 15 seconds ago, stars were present in a bunch of the early proposals, and one version of Coudenhove Kalergi's flag even had a circle of yellow stars. There was also this sort of famous example of a circle of stars being used to represent states. But whatever the inspiration, in 1955, Levy asked a designer to propose a circle of yellow stars on a blue background. The background sort of had to be blue, not because of any special Euro meaning, but basically because every other color was taken. Red was communism, green was Islam, yellow was quarantine, white was surrender, and black was pirates. So, blue. And there were 15 members of the council at the time, so Levy proposed 15 stars. Simple, right? But then West Germany was like, stop, collaborate, and listen. One of the members of the council at the time is the Saar region, this tiny little strip of coal country that France and Germany have been fighting over for 10,000 years. Since coal is how you make steel, and steel is how you make war, the Allies gave the region to France after World War II. Germany's afraid that if Saarland gets a star on the flag, it might become its own fake little country rather than coming back to Germany. And given European history, this isn't totally unrealistic. So Levy can't propose a flag with 15 stars because Germany will veto it. If he proposes a flag with 14 stars, the Saar region will veto it. 13's an unlucky number, so what about 12 stars? There's 12 signs of the zodiac, 12 months of the year, 12 Olympic deities, 12 disciples. It sort of works. And most importantly, since it means everything, it means nothing. Nobody can object. Levy puts in the proposal and it's unanimously approved. Europe finally has a flag. But hang on. It's still 1955. The EU hasn't been invented yet, and the Council's still pretty obscure even by European standards. It has this sexy new flag, but none of its members are actually flying it. Also, the Council has competition.
Bombs go off when I enter the building.
Okay, so it sounds even boringer than the Council, but the European Economic Community is where European countries start doing actual stuff together. They're removing tariffs, they're subsidizing agriculture, they're forming a customs union, all the fascinating stuff we associate with the EU today. By the early 80s, it's clear that the community is going to be the headlining act of European cooperation. When the Council realizes that the United States of Europe isn't going to happen, it changes its mission and becomes a sister institution to the EU. Meanwhile, as it's growing in power and membership, the European community doesn't have a symbol. At official events, it just flies the flags of all of its members. There's 10 of them now, and this is getting unwieldy. There's also the issue of identity. All our favorite European institutions are up and running by now, but they don't really have a unifying theme. People don't know what they do or what they stand for. The European community has all this power, but no personality. So the community calls up its old buddy, the Council of Europe. Reaching back to the 1950s for its symbol gives the community a sense of heritage and promotes the idea that the European Union is the result of cooperation rather than competition. Also, the design's already been approved, so this is way faster than going through the whole proposal process again. The Council agrees, and the flag is relaunched as the symbol of all of Europe. And European countries never disagreed on anything again. Except, there's one last caveat. The European community doesn't officially become the EU until 1993, but it spends a lot of that time in a debate with its members about just how much Euro-ness they're willing to accept. A lot of European countries are worried that the European flag will eventually replace their own. And this has sort of come true. Despite the fact that no one here knows what it actually means, you do see the European flag absolutely everywhere on this continent. Outside of Europe, it's become a symbol of democracy and development, unlike any individual European country. And it even gets shoutouts in other countries' flags. But that last compromise? The EU flag isn't one. It's technically an emblem that is eligible to be reproduced on rectangular pieces of fabric. A flag, after all, would be stating something. But an emblem? Who can object to that?